Good afternoon, everyone. I am Janet Roman. I'm the director of the University of South Florida Doctor of Nursing Practice Program. Although we are disappointed that we're not holding the ceremony in person, we are delighted that you're able to join us today. The past year has been challenging for everyone, and we appreciate the flexibility and the creative spirit that our students and faculty have demonstrated.
Welcome to the University of South Florida College of Nursing Doctoral Celebration. I'm Usha Menon, Dean and Professor in the College of Nursing. Thank you all for tuning in on this special occasion. For those of you earning your doctoral degrees, what a milestone this is for you. For those family and friends who are watching, thank you for supporting our students on their journey. They couldn't have done it without you. What an extraordinary time to graduate. We are living through a historic event that has transformed our life in ways we never imagined, and the full effects of which are still unknown. As doctoral graduates from the College of Nursing, you are now armed with the skills to advance science, implement new systems, and influence policy in the face of the world's worst pandemic. We wish you the very best as you enter the world with these skills. As we continue to navigate through the new normal, we hope you will take the initiative to make a difference where it counts the most for the health of our communities, the nation, and the world. For nearly five decades, the USF College of Nursing has placed the highest priority on nursing education and the student experience. We pride ourselves in educating nurse leaders who are ready to make meaningful contributions to healthcare, both locally and around the globe. We're honored to have played a part in helping you reach this important day. Be safe and be well. Congratulations on your success, and go Bulls!
Hello, my name is Marcia Johansson, and I'm the Adult-Gerontology Acute Care Concentration Director. This year's graduating class is a group of dedicated and talented healthcare professionals. One outstanding example is Amanda Fitch Nagy. We are pleased that she is speaking with all of us today to provide some perspective about the journey she experienced in this program.
Good afternoon, friends, family, students, and faculty. I apologize, I'm recovering from some laryngitis. And this is about the best voice I've had in a few days. My name is Amanda Nagy, and today we gather to celebrate the end of our doctoral training and the beginning of a new and exciting future. I'm honored to celebrate this great accomplishment with you all today. There are many things to be grateful for in this DNP program, but most importantly, I would like to thank the supportive and well-educated faculty and mentors that we've had. I am in awe of the adaptability and continued ease with which the deans, directors, faculty, and support staff have amended the program over the past year with the challenges the COVID-19 pandemic placed on the university. The doctoral program encouraged an independent learning environment, but the pandemic made it challenging. Finding immersion experiences and project site opportunities were scarce. Not only did the program directors create ways for us students to continue with our projects and coursework without a hiccup, but they created new and innovative ways to educate and provide learning experiences that were safe and pertinent to each of us and our project focuses. The safety precautions and services offered, including mental health support, COVID testing, and even vaccination, were always quickly made available to the students. I very much felt the care and support of the university and College of Nursing through these difficult times. I was a non-traditional student, if you can call it that. I started out practicing nurse practitioner in a local primary care office and found myself at the University of South Florida pursuing my DNP in 2016. I wanted to establish myself as a leader in my organization and prepare me as a future educator. The DMP program has helped guide me to become a more caring clinician and has taught me to continually look to the future of healthcare and what my role is as a nurse practitioner, what I can do to change the structures and policies of the health systems in hopes to reduce health inequity, continue to improve access to care in underserved communities, reduce cost, and improve health outcomes. Now, these all are lofty ideas to some, but over the past many decades of this profession's existence, it already proves to be a more attainable possibility. I'm proud to be a University of South Florida Doctor of Nursing Practice graduate, and so proud of all of my peers graduating with me today. To end any commencement speech, I must leave you with an inspirational quote, and this from another Amanda, Amanda Gorman, who many of you may know from the inaugural presidential speech. Part of her poem read, "We will not be turned around or interrupted by intimidation because we know our inaction and our inertia will be the inheritance of the next generation. Become the future." We can apply this to our own circumstances. Let us stand together in support of each other, encouraging the care for others in this great sacrifice as nurses. We are the future. Thank you to all of you nurses who have truly worked the front lines, who have sacrificed your own care and emotion to spend countless hours helping the sick, caring for the underserved, volunteering to spend hours on end swabbing noses, and now giving injections. You are truly heroes and a part of history, and I want to honor you. Thank you and congratulations, doctoral class of 2021. Thank you again.
Hello, I'm Theresa Beckie, director of the PhD in Nursing Science program. Students who earn a PhD from this program can affect the lives of millions of people by creating the science that impacts patients, families, and communities. During this past semester, one of our students successfully defended her dissertation and has earned a PhD. We have invited Tina Mason to share her work with you today, and I hope you will watch this presentation, which appears later in this celebration.
Hello, I am Denise Maguire, the Senior Associate Dean of Alumni Community and Global Engagement. In recent weeks, our students completed their final projects and they presented posters that summarized their work. The other judges and I have reviewed their presentations, and I am pleased to announce the winners of first, second, and third place. I invite you to watch their presentations as well. Placing third is Amanda Fitch Nagy for her project titled Improving Outcomes in Adult Hispanics Through a Culturally Tailored Diabetic Program. Placing second is Tanya Brabble for her project titled Implementation of a Transition in Care Protocol to Avoid Delays in Care for Male Patients Experiencing Acute Urinary Retention. And placing first is Samantha Stevenson for her project titled Implementation of a Nurse-Driven Asthma Protocol to Improve Timeliness of Medication Administration and Length of Stay in a Pediatric Emergency Department. Congratulations to all our winners.
Hello, I'm Tracey Taylor, Associate Dean of the Graduate Clinical Programs at the USF College of Nursing. Although we are not able to have an official commencement ceremony this semester, I want to congratulate you all on earning your doctoral hoods. You may wonder where the tradition of hooding came from, so I'll provide a little background. The hooding ceremony is believed to have originated in European universities in the 12th century. The ceremony was a way to recognize graduating students as they began their scholarly careers. Hooded robes were often required for warmth in unheated medieval libraries, and now they're mostly symbolic. Universities eventually differentiated students by their academic majors, and colors were added as accents to robes and hoods to signify these distinctions. The color for the nursing profession is apricot. As you can see here on my hood, this is the detail in apricot velvet that surrounds the outside. On the inside of the doctoral hood, you will see the colors of your alma mater. So the inside of your hoods will have USF full colors. Today, wearing a hood represents a commitment to scholarly life. I encourage you to cherish your doctoral hood as I do mine. I hope it will inspire you all to become lifelong learners.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Brittany Hay, Director of the Adult-Gerontology and Family Primary Care Concentrations. It's my pleasure to share the names of candidates and the titles of their doctoral projects. Tanya Brattle, project title, Implementation of a Transition in Care Protocol to Avoid Delays in Care for Male Patients Experiencing Acute Urinary Retention. Faculty mentor, Dr. Brittany Hay. Amanda Fitch Nagy, project title, Improving Outcomes in Adult Hispanics Through a Culturally Tailored Diabetic Program. Faculty mentor, Dr. Denise Maguire. Emanuela Pierre Charles, project title, Enhanced Telehealth Service with Mobile App Annie and Telephone Support to Improve Self-Care and Quality of Life of Patients with Heart Failure. Faculty member, Dr. Ponrathi Atlingham. India Presley Boyd, project title, Nurse Practitioner Oversight of Heart Failure Patients. Faculty member, Dr. Candace Burns. Ashley Raymond, project title, Reducing Inappropriate ER Utilization with an ALF COVID-19 Preparedness Toolkit. Faculty member, Dr. Brittany Hay. Samantha Stevenson, project title, Implementation of a Nurse-Driven Asthma Protocol to Improve Timeliness of Medication Administration and Length of Stay in the Pediatric Emergency Department. Faculty member, Dr. Shar Smith. Tina Mason, dissertation defense, title, Quality of Life of Older Adults with Complicated Grief Receiving Accelerated Resolution Therapy, a Mixed Methods Study. Faculty mentor, Dr. Constance Vyshovsky. Congratulations to you all.
Hello, everyone. I am Christina Bricker, Assistant Dean of Graduate Clinical Programs. At this time, I invite all our graduates and any other nurses who are watching to stand and read the International Council of Nurses Pledge. In full knowledge of the obligations I am undertaking, I promise to care for the sick with all the skills and understanding I possess without regard to race, creed, color, politics, or social status, sparing no effort to conserve life, to alleviate suffering, and to promote health. I will respect at all times the dignity and religious beliefs of the patients under my care, holding in confidence all personal information entrusted to me, and refraining from any action that might endanger life or health. I will endeavor to keep my professional knowledge and skill at the highest level, and to give loyal support and cooperation to all members of the health team. I will do my utmost to honor the International Code of Nursing Ethics and to uphold the integrity of the professional nurse.
Before we conclude this special occasion, we want to take a moment to thank all of the people who made it possible. Please watch the credits at the end of this video as we recognize everyone who worked behind the scenes to record the video clips and organize this virtual event. To our graduates, you are now alumni of the USF College of Nursing and will always be part of our family. Remember that the Alumni Society is here to support you. We offer you opportunities for networking, participation in community events, and a place to continue your relationship with your alma mater. In the coming days, you will each receive by mail a medal that marks your achievement as a doctoral graduate. The medals are given to you through a generous contribution by Sigma Theta Tau International via the local chapter of Delta Beta Chapter at Large. We are grateful for their ongoing support of our Bull Nurse doctoral graduates. In that same package will be a printed program of today's events, as well as award certificates for the poster presentation winners. We hope that these items will help you commemorate this special occasion. As we close the ceremony, remember that there are many powerful experiences ahead of you. Whether you are in clinical practice, administration, academia, or a private endeavor, you are the next generation of nursing leaders. Thank you for joining us today. We all wish you the very best.
Good afternoon. My name is Samantha Stevenson. I'm a certified acute care pediatric nurse practitioner and DNP candidate. I will be presenting an overview of the findings of my DNP scholarly project as a final requirement for completion of the DNP program at the University of South Florida. In brief, asthma is one of the leading causes of respiratory conditions among the pediatric population, affecting an estimated 6 million children in the United States. An acute care asthma exacerbation, otherwise known as an asthma flare, results in respiratory distress, difficulty breathing, and wheezing. Parents of children with acute asthma exacerbation often seek care and treatment in the emergency department. Management of acute asthma exacerbations places a hefty burden on the length of stay in pediatric EDs. This has resulted in approximately 1.8 million visits a year. Subsequently, this results in prolonged ED length of stay and reduction in patient quality of care, increased patient morbidity, and prolonged intervals between recognition of illness and appropriate timely treatment, such as short-acting beta agonists. So how do we improve timeliness to first medication in acute asthma exacerbation and decreasing ED length of stay among these particular patients? Well, utilization of nurse-driven protocols. Studies have shown that when utilized effectively, nurse-driven protocols can decrease ED length of stay and reduce unnecessary resource utilization. While the evidence points to use of nurse-driven treatment protocols as an effective process to decreasing length of stay, there is relatively little research to demonstrate the correlation between implementation of an asthma-specific nurse-driven ED protocol and increased timeliness of first albuterol treatment. This QI project aim to improve the implementation, improve this phenomenon by implementing an asthma-specific, nurse-driven ED protocol for pediatric patients who presented with acute asthma exacerbation. There were two outcome measures for this project. time from arrival to the ED to first albuterol administration, defined as T1, and ED length of stay. The project is implemented at a freestanding children's hospital in Central Florida with a dedicated 18-bed emergency department. The ED staffs 24 providers, numerous pediatric residents, pediatric nurses, respiratory therapists, several students, and medics. The participants for this project consisted of children aged 2 to 18 years of age with either a known history of asthma or prior albuterol use with wheezing, who presented with symptoms consistent with acute asthma exacerbation. Patients who met inclusion criteria received standard treatment and care, which included albuterol and ipratropium nebulizer or an MDI or inhaler treatments. Now let me draw your attention to the tools utilized for this QI project. As you can see with the pathway, an EDRN asthma triage protocol was developed to assist the triage nurse in promptly identifying patients who met criteria for the protocol, as well as asthma scoring for initiation of treatment. For the scoring tool, Seattle Children's Hospital Respiratory Scoring Tool was adopted. This scoring tool has effectively demonstrated evidence as a valid pediatric tool for inter-observer reliability for asthma scoring. Data was collected retrospectively and prospectively via chart audits that were manually performed to compare T1 and ED length of stay among both pre- and post-intervention groups, analyzed via an independent sample T-test. Now, let me draw your attention to the green table on the poster. Once education and implementation of the pathway and respiratory scoring tool were completed on the unit, ongoing data collection over the subsequent 3 months revealed a statistically significant reduction in T1 by an average of 27.8 minutes. Also, among both groups, there was a statistically significant reduction in ED length of stay by an average of 34.7 minutes. The findings of this project demonstrate that use of a nurse-initiated asthma protocol in the ED can effectively decrease time from arrival to first albuterol treatment and subsequent ED length of stay. One major limitation of this project was the COVID-19 pandemic, especially among the pediatric population. The low rate of serious illness among children, as well as the decrease in return to school among children, resulted in a dramatic reduction in the sample size of the post-intervention group. However, the data was still able to successfully demonstrate that initiation of a nurse-driven ED protocol was effective at reduction of time to treatment as well as length of stay. Furthermore, this overwhelmingly suggests that utilization of a nurse-driven protocol in the ED can rapidly assess and initiate treatment prior to provider assessment and therefore optimize patient care by improving outcomes, increasing nurse autonomy, and improving ED productivity. Thank you very much for your time and interest in this DNP scholarly project.
Hello, my name is Tanya Bravel, and today I'm presenting a quality improvement project that was designed to improve transitions in care in male patients age 65 and older experiencing acute urinary retention. Acute urinary retention caused by bladder alar obstruction from an enlarged prostate leads to a sudden onset of suprapubic pain and a feeling of urgency that cannot be alleviated. 1 in 10 men age 70 and 1 in 3 men age 80 and older will experience AUR. In fact, the one-year predicted mortality rate in men age 85 and older is approximately 33% higher than the general population. To begin my project, a needs assessment was performed. I uncovered an increase in ED utilization in this population secondary to the underlying challenge of obtaining an appointment with urology as an outpatient. The problem became even more challenging when the patient was not already established with a urologist. Due to the shortage of urologists, these patients would have an average wait of 4 to 6 weeks to be seen. Evidence-based practice guidelines point to having the catheter removed for avoiding trial within 5 days. 5 days to 4 to 6 weeks is a huge difference. This problem stimulated the aim of this project, which was to decrease the number of return ED visits by 25% for men aged 65 and older experiencing acute urinary retention within 60 days following implementation of a urologic transition and care protocol. The big question: does implementation of a hospital-to-office urologic transition and care protocol for male patients over the age of 65 with acute urinary retention reduce the rate of ED return by 25% within 60 days compared to the usual practice. The framework for this quality improvement project was developed from the Institute for Healthcare Improvement's Model for Improvement, which incorporates cyclic evaluation and implementation. The utilization of the PDSA cycles helped to uncover any deficits or changes needed throughout the course of implementation. Integrated into this framework was Mary D. Naylor's transitional care model. As best stated by Naylor, we are creating a bridge across the chasm for patients that otherwise get lost in the healthcare shuffle. Poor communication and lack of access inhibit desired health outcomes. The subjects for this transition in care protocol included males aged 65 and older with the diagnosis of AUR. Exclusion criteria was incorporated into this population. The Quality Improvement Transition and Care Protocol took place in a large outpatient clinic and a nonprofit tertiary research and academic medical center located in Central Florida. An evidence-based pre-appointment checklist with four questions was developed to increase success at the voiding trial appointment for this patient population. There is good evidence that shows limb movement is associated with restoration of bladder function as well as avoiding constipation. So those questions were incorporated in the questionnaire. The staff was educated on this questionnaire and the patients were contacted prior to their appointment to assure best possible outcomes of the voiding trial appointment. After IRB submission and approval, a baseline was established with de-identified data that was collected over a 60-day period and analyzed to determine 30-day ED return rate from an index admission. This took place from September 10th to December 9th. During that time frame, ongoing education of the new transition and care protocol was undertaken with all of the staff. A workflow process was established, and the graphic for that workflow is present on my poster for further viewing. Around day 30 of implementation, we performed a PDSA cycle to see what was going well and what may need improvement. From December 10th to March 9th, de-identified data was collected. Post-intervention data for that 90-day time period was analyzed to determine 30-day ED return rate. A chi-square test was performed to compare pre- and post-intervention 30-day ED utilization rates. Looking at percentages, approximately 35% of the pre-intervention patients returned to the emergency department. When compared to the post-intervention patients who had a 16% ED return rate, a 19% decrease in ED utilization was appreciated. This fell slightly short of our goal of a 25% reduction rate. However, as you can see, it was still a clinically significant decrease. With a p-value of less than 0.07, we did not meet statistical significance in this brief time span. A few things we learned along the way. When reviewing the data from the voiding trials, a much larger number of patients than anticipated failed a trial of void and had to go on for further testing and procedures. We did hear positive statements from the care navigators and staff iterating that the process was so much easier and the scheduling was easier and faster to obtain appointment times. The development of a urologic transitioning care model shows promise in decreasing ED utilization. A clinically significant reduction in the number of men utilizing the ED was appreciated. Despite falling slightly short of the 25% reduction rate we had hoped for, progress was made towards the goal with a 19% reduction rate amongst this population. Workflow changes were well received, and the evidence-based pre-appointment questionnaire assured an optimal chance of success at the voiding trial appointment. Lastly, a decrease to cost to the patient and the healthcare system was appreciated in the reduction of ED utilization and iatrogenic infections. We encountered some limitations to include the use of aggregate data in a small sample size, which limits rigor in a 60-day project period. Implementation of this QI project during a pandemic in which patients are reluctant to visit the ED contributes to a smaller than usual sample size. Overall, the patient ED utilization for all causes is down approximately 40% throughout the pandemic. Data extraction from the electronic health record was challenging as there are interoperability problems when working with two different systems. When deciding upon this topic matter, it was apparent that acute urinary retention is a growing problem. However, a paucity of current evidence to guide AUR protocols or interventions to prevent ED utilization exists. This DNP-led project lays the groundwork to inspire future exploration. The DNP-prepared nurse leads and positively impacts urologic patient care and reduces unnecessary costs. Looking to the future, sustainability can be achieved by performing a second PDSA cycle over 3 months, and if outcomes remain steady, this urologic transition and care protocol can be spread as a model for other practices throughout Central Florida and beyond. I have a QR code that links to all the references utilized throughout the creation of this project. Thank you for allowing me to share my DNP project with you, and I hope it inspires future transition and care protocols. Decreasing one ED trip for one patient will always be worthy of my attention and ongoing dedication to our profession.
So yes, I'm very excited to share my DNP project on improving outcomes in adult Hispanics through a culturally tailored diabetes program. Finding ways to address the needs of the Hispanic minority to help control their diabetes has been a challenge, as there are many barriers to the care of the Hispanic patient. As you may know, diabetes is a growing epidemic in the U.S., affecting over 34 million adults. Also, disproportionately, ethnic minorities are increasing in that group. Hispanics make the biggest group of ethnic minority in diabetes, and unfortunately, increase the risk of poor control and outcomes. They are 66% more likely than non-Hispanic whites to develop diabetes. My project purpose was to improve specific health outcomes in the Hispanic adults with uncontrolled type 2 diabetes through an individualized and culturally tailored education program. Diabetes self-management education and support has been shown to improve diabetes care and is cost-effective. I was able to recruit 19 qualified, self-identified Hispanic patients with an established diagnosis of type 2 diabetes within an internal medicine practice local to Tampa. The Leninger's culture care theory and quality improvement model helped guide the program. In these patients, they are specifically selected based on their uncontrolled status with a hemoglobin A1C greater than 7%. They also were self-identified Hispanic, so this wasn't assumed fact, and they could speak English or Spanish. Monthly, live, or virtual visits were required to gather baseline data and implement the program interventions. Each participant was screened for individual self-care needs using a validated tool called the Summary of Diabetes Self-Care Activities Questionnaire. This tool specifically addresses the five main self-care behaviors: physical activity, diet, medication adherence, foot exams, and glucose monitoring. This was also used to determine behavior changes from the interventions given. BMI was calculated using the in-office weight and height measurements, and average fasting glucose values were collected from the patient's own glucometer to track changes in their health outcomes. Self-care deficits were reviewed using the SDSCA questionnaire. Culturally relevant handouts were reviewed and given during the sessions, with added self-care diabetes education in the preferred language of the patient. Specific self-care goals were set at each of the visits, and weekly text messages were sent to reinforce the live meetings through coaching, and opportunities were given for the patients to ask questions related to their health goals. Of the initial 19 recruited over the 12-week period, only 12 completed the full program. Self-care activity scores, BMI, and average fasting glucose were used to determine the relevance and effect of the project. Data analysis through a t-test and ANOVA process showed statistical significance throughout. As you can see, SDSCA scores improved by 45%, BMI decreased by 2.5%, and average fasting glucose values decreased by more than 20%. Reinforced education works to improve self-care behaviors. Improved self-care behaviors results in better health outcomes and improved diabetes control. Primary care nurse practitioners, or practitioners in general, have the opportunity to address barriers, implement cultural traditions, and assess for self-care needs of the individual in order to enhance the individual self-care needs of the Hispanic patient. Limitations include poor attrition, low sample size, and of course, we have to mention the COVID-19 pandemic, which may have influenced both of these as well. Regardless, the results show promising. This is something worthwhile, and I hope to further implement this in my practice. Thank you so much.
Hello, this is Tina Mason, and this is a condensed version of my mixed methods dissertation in less than 10 minutes. Complicated grief affects tens of millions of people worldwide, presenting a global health concern. Complicated grief is persistent and intense beyond 6 months after the loss, with continued yearning, longing, sadness, maladaptive thoughts, dysfunctional behaviors, and a worsening of one's mental and physical health. Quality of life, as we know, is subjective and cultural, often described in the domains of physical, mental, social, and environmental health. Accelerated resolution therapy, or ART, was the intervention used in this study. Using eye movements, the therapist will help them reimagine and re-script the traumatic events. The purpose of my study was to describe quality of life of older adults with complicated grief via the analysis and integration of both qualitative and quantitative data. There were three aims for this study. First, to qualitatively describe self-reported quality of life with interviews. Secondly, to quantitative examine changes in quality of life with an instrument from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. With this, the hypothesis was older adults experiencing complicated grief will report improved quality of life with the completion of ART. Lastly, to understand changes in quality of life with the integration of the data. My dissertation was a sub-analysis of quality of life from a larger parent study that received funding from the National Institute on Aging. 54 were recruited from Suncoast Hospice. They were randomly assigned to either receive ART immediately or 4 weeks after enrollment, and they received up to 4 sessions. For the first qualitative aim, there was a thematic analysis conducted with 2 other coders using a codebook and field notes. For the second aim, I examined a Healthy Days module, conducted pair-T tests and repeated measure of ANOVA, and more importantly, fitted a multi-level linear model. This is the Healthy Days module. I used questions 2 through 4, which are on the same scale as 0 to 30. A higher number indicates poor quality of life for physical health, mental health, and an impact on usual activities. The third aim consisted of an informational matrix using Microsoft Excel. The first aim had 29 individuals with a digital recording of their interviews. And I'm not going to go over demographics and clinical characteristics for all the aims, but they're similar in that the majority were white widow females and average age around 68. 1.2 average number of comorbidities, the majority having no hospitalizations and 3 or greater visits to their provider. The themes are listed here in order of endorsement, mental function, followed by self-management, social support, and physical function. The first 2 themes have sub-themes listed here in the table. My second aim had about 27 participants. Demographics are similar, except there was a difference in the 2 groups with employment. 79% were retired in the immediate treatment group, 43% disabled and waitlist, and this was a statistically significant difference. I now begin to report the average quality of life scores. They were 39 at baseline, 27 end of treatment, and 21 8 weeks post-therapy. The multi-level linear model was fitted twice with and without one potential outlier. And without the outlier, it was a tighter fit with time explaining 7.8%, group 11%, and the slope of the growth curve being statistically significant, supporting the hypothesis. For the third aim, I used the integrated analysis of 21 participants. The only difference here was that this group was higher educated at bachelor's or graduate, but this was not statistically significant between the groups. No differences really with the clinical characteristics. And here's my matrix. So I looked at number of comorbidities, single versus multiple deaths, and relationship. The 4 themes, the quality of life score at end of study, and the change from baseline. Overall, you could see that 2/3 had experienced a multiple death, 62% were spouses, 1/3 had no comorbidities, and 38% had one. And the quality of life themes and sub-themes are endorsed in the same order. Concordance was checked and was found to be moderate, 50% for physical function, 71% for mental function. This analysis had a lot of interesting linkages, so I'm going to point out a couple. Those with a single death endorsed social support and physical function at a higher rate than multiple deaths. So a lack of history of prior deaths may highlight the need for social support or emphasize its loss with a reflection on one's own health. The groups were equal in the endorsement of physical function. Only spouses endorse self-agency and 80% of spouses endorse self-efficacy. The two that describe finances were females and wives. Only females endorse joy and social support, so role and gender may play a role in the perception of the meaning of quality of life. Two scored poorly at the end of the study. One, unfortunately, had a second death, a suicide within 2 months. Two had an increase in quality of life scores, but did not score poorly at either of these 2 points, and they both had a single death. And that we do need to develop an understanding of the dose response and tailor interventions. For the full integration, 4 participants endorsed all 3 themes. They had at least 1 comorbidity, and this may lead to a richer description of quality of life. 6 reported a great improvement in quality of life, anywhere from 33 to 70 points, and they all had experienced multiple deaths. So here this may indicate that past experiences with death or lifting of a greater burden may improve the responsiveness to treatment. So for my discussion briefly, my 4 themes in my dissertation were comparable to 4 other studies of older adults that were community dwelling. The only one that didn't show up was environmental health, but in the context of complicated grief, that is understandable. For my second aim, I did find one study with art and quality of life did improve with those with post-traumatic stress disorder, but whether reducing complicated grief is the mechanism through which art improves quality of life or not needs further examination. I found no studies with complicated grief treatment and quality of life, and this is our current gold standard therapy. So art may have similar results to complicated grief treatment in a shorter period of time and can potentially improve quality of life as well. 91% reported fair to good quality of life at the end of the study, supporting the hypothesis. And in summary, the experience with death may play a role in responsiveness, and relationship, gender, and comorbidities may play a role in perceptions of quality of life. Implications for nursing include assessing for quality of life and complicated grief throughout the caregiving experience and post-death. The multidimensional aspects of quality of life can provide insight into individualized patient and family-centered care, and the ontology of nursing science presents a foundation for further research on grief. There is a need to evaluate valid and reliable quality of life measures for this population. Larger, more diverse samples are needed, and data collection beyond 8 weeks after therapy ends. I'd like to develop and test a screening instrument for complicated grief. We need further research with ART. And due to the current historical context of this pandemic, studies on the risk, duration, and presentation of complicated grief may be warranted. In conclusion, this dissertation does contribute to the body of knowledge related to older adults, caregiving, complicated grief, mind-body therapies, and quality of life, while presenting preliminary data supporting further research of the effect of art on complicated grief, quality of life, and dosing. Thank you.